Hello, I'm Mike with this week's new and trending AI tools you cannot afford to miss. It's been a very busy week with announcements from Google, OpenAI, and Grok, and we're going to look at them all. From memories to remembering whatever you say, Grok is now on board. Gemini can run apps right inside AI Studio, and OpenAI released new models, including Codex CLI, which we're going to look at right now, and it's pretty incredible. So not only is this powerful and working from the command line to make apps on command, but it's also open source and really easy to install. I mean, really easy to install. So it's an automated coder that works in your terminal if you're on a Mac, or of course it can work in Linux, also on Windows, and you just need to run this one command here. Now, before I go ahead and run the command, I'm just checking down here for system requirements, and we can actually see it runs on macOS, but we do need Node version 22 or newer. That's very important. Git and enough RAM to run it. So I'd better go ahead and install Node at 22 using this brew command. Okay, that only took a few seconds. Let's copy and paste the install command for Codex CLI, and it's done. And then we enter this command along with the API key we just generated and make sure that that's there in our system. Next up, it looks like we can run interactively just by running Codex from our command line. And look at that, OpenAI Codex in research preview is available. Now, it can be dangerous to run a coding agent outside of a Git repo. Are you sure? Right in my downloads folder. Let's say yes. Okay, and we'll maximize this a bit and have a look at things. So we're working in the downloads folder of my Mac with 04 mini and approval suggest. So I have to approve things, which is good for the moment. Let's start with an easy one. Tell me the files in the current directory. And Codex CLI is thinking about it and it's performed perfectly. Yes, it's found a few hidden Premiere Pro projects, also a backup folder and MikeBest2024.jpg. This is interesting because there is this picture of me here. Let's try this, convert this image to ASCII art, which seems to be all the rage right now. And it seems to be running this command here a couple of times, actually. Oh my goodness. You can rerun or tweak this with different dimensions. Look at that. That is ASCII art of me. Insane. Now, I know in the official OpenAI demo, they did an ASCII art thing in real time using the webcam, but this is really cool. And that took me just a prompt and a couple of confirmations, and I was there. Now, let's run the command it suggests. Oh, wow. Okay. I have my own command line tool to make ASCII art in whatever width I want. Yes, that's right. I can make it smaller. I can make it tiny postage stamp size, and the ASCII art generator is working for me. That was a really simple example, so let's try something a little more complex with Codex CLI from OpenAI. So let's go ahead, use my favorite text editor to edit the config, and here you'll see it asks for a model. Now, by default, it's 04 mini, but let's go for the big fat one, the 03 model, and then exit out that hitting yes to save the changes. Okay, next, I'm going to use part of this command, which is Codex dash dash approval mode full auto. So I'm going to work in full automation mode. Essentially, this is going to run everything from the command line for me and build my app autonomously. It's a little bit scary, but don't worry, OpenAI built in some safety nets, mainly the fact if you read the repo here that it's zero setup, as you've seen, very easy to get started, full approval, but safe and secure. It runs network disabled by default and also directory sandboxed as well. And essentially what that means in humans terms is it can't reach out to the internet and it can't do anything else in any other directory on your computer. So it's actually fairly safe to run. Now, actually talking about directory sandboxing, I'm actually going to switch to a Codex app directory. So Codex will only be able to work in that specific area. Now, as we're working with 03, I'm going to make it quite complex, and I want it to create an app that explores the best geocaches by favorite points, last found logs as well being positive, and then makes a walking trail that I can export to a Garmin watch. That's a pretty complex prompt, and if you've never heard of geocaching, it's essentially the world's biggest treasure hunt, and you can go to a real-life map, and you can find geocaches all around you wherever you are in the world, and it's a brilliant way of finding real-life treasure out there in the wild, wherever you're traveling in the world with your family. So let's make an app that makes geocaching even easier. I've written here to Codex in approval mode full auto, create an app that explores the best geocaches by favorite points and last found logs. being positive, of course. I want geocaches that were recently found, plus a walking trail on OpenStreetMap that I can export to my Garmin watch. Let's hit enter and watch as OpenAI Codex works away in this directory. I click yes to that. Let's make this big and watch this app be created in front of my very eyes. Okay, now we can see it's writing some code. It's running lots of Python commands here. Okay, that was really quick. It's given me quick start commands here that I can run. So now I've exited out of Codex. Let's run the install requirements. There's quite a few of them. Okay, that's cool. And with that done, all I should need to do is run this final command. Okay, you can now view the app in your browser. Let's have a look at what O3 created. Okay, first I've got to say this looks really cool and bang on what I was asking for. Geocache route planner. Upload a geocaching pocket query file. Okay, with my Exmoor National Park loaded, let's start the geocache search. And look at this, it's found me a brilliant route with caches along there and the last log type all found. Some good favorite points, latitudes and longitudes. Let's go. This is a one-shot app. Let's compute the walking route. And look at that. That is insane. Not only has it marked out all the geocaches here, but it's given me a proposed walking route along walking paths. Now I can download this route as a GPX. Look at that. It's downloaded here, the Pinkery Trail. And I can upload it to my Garmin watch and have family fun this weekend in Exmoor National Park. And this can all be done with O3 or O4 Mini now on the new OpenAI Codex CLI tool. It's pretty cool. Next up, let's take a look at Google AI Studio. AI.dev is where you need to go to get this brilliant app. Now, this is getting better by the day, and Google announced a couple of new things. First of all, starter apps that I really have to show you. This is absolutely incredible. Not only have you got some examples of apps that you can now run in Google's AI Studio, like Gemini 95, I really like the retro feel that it will fire everything up. Now, as this is loading, well, it loaded very quickly, you can actually look at the brilliant code that goes on here, the HTML, the CSS, if you like, so you can see what happens under the hood. It's got its own little web browser. But what I found really cool is you can actually play Doom. And wow, look at this. This is actually real life Doom playing on my browser here, and I'm actually controlling it. So you've got to remember, this is inside of Google's Gemini. And it's actually happening right now. This is like a simulation inside a simulation. Kind of meta for AI, isn't it? Let's shoot the barrel. Yes, I'm getting carried away there. If you're enjoying what you see so far, do throw a like and subscribe as I do videos like this weekly. So now you can see starter app examples. Let's go in and create our own app. And I'm going to start with an empty app. Now, you see there's something here to put in your TS, your HTML, and your CSS. Unfortunately, Google AI Studio can't generate this code yet. So I'll create something really simple inside Cursor that we can run inside of Google's AI Studio. Here I am inside Cursor, which, by the way, if you go into the settings cog up in the top right and look at models, they have been adding models like a beast recently. And you'll find things like GPT 4.1 announced this week are available in there. Also, the newest Grok models are available, and also O3 along with O4 Mini, all available to use inside one of my favorite AI coding tools, Cursor. Now here, I'm just going to keep this really simple. Create an app with one HTML, CSS, and TS file that can find the best ancient Druid sites in Exmoor and Dartmoor, and then display them on a Google map. Now it's going to work. I'm using the thinking model of Claude 3.7 Sonnet. Okay, look at that. It seems to have generated everything. So now I'm just going to go in and make sure I've got my API key in here. That's for Google Maps. And then we'll copy everything into Google AI Studio. Here's the HTML. Pop that into HTML. TypeScript. We'll put that into the TS tab. And then for CSS, again, copy and paste. And I can already see it forming. Wow, look at that. That was literally one shot inside Cursor with Claude Sonnet 3.7 thinking, and then getting all of this code copied and pasted into Google AI Studio. Now, I'm under no doubt that Google will eventually implement the ability to generate the code inside AI Studio as well in the near future. That's what I hope. We've got Grimsbound. That sounds interesting. Merivale Stone Rose sounds good. Scorehill Stone Circle. Grey Weathers. This is all accurate stuff. And over in Exmoor, we've got the Tar Steps and the Valley of the Rocks. Ancient, beautiful Druid sites to visit in the southwest of England on my family vacation. And that was in one prompt. Not only that, but I've also noticed that if I scroll down, it's got site information here, and it actually pulls in some information that it's an ancient rock formation with spiritual significance and possible druidic connections. Now, again, as well as viewing or not viewing the code, we can also look at the directory structure of everything here. And of course, we've got the app running here inside our browser in AI Studio. We've also got these options up here to make a copy of the app or download the app if we wish. So I can do all of that. Let's make a copy so we can copy it anywhere we like so. We can also download it. So that will download the files in a nice zip file for me. And I can add a cloud project to apply API keys natively right inside AI Studio. Okay, and finally, Grok got some superpowers. Super Grok is my membership level. I absolutely love Grok, and I can actually go in here to my settings and go into data controls here. Now, first of all, I can personalize Grok using X. I can't believe I've never had that enabled. Let's switch that on so it can use stuff from my profile and location and settings and preferences. But also, this is beta, this is new, you can allow Grok to remember details from your previous conversations. You can also delete conversations as needed. Temporary chats never stored. So this essentially now gives Grok memories on you, and essentially it makes it super personal. So with those features enabled, let's say, what do you know about me? And then tag my user tag just to make sure it gets all the details needed. Now, not only is it looking me up, but it's also going to remember this stuff. And it says you're enthusiastic about technology, particularly Tesla's advancements. Oh, how interesting. And also, as I discovered with last week's video, slightly controversial. Anyway, it knows that I recently attended NAB in Las Vegas. Indeed, I did. I tested Tesla's full self-driving. Yes, I did. Version 13 on a Cybertruck and Model 3. This is scary accurate. I described it as insane, which is true. And talk about the complex scenarios. Beyond that, don't have many personal details about you. My knowledge is limited as to what's publicly shared. And then it says I can clarify and go on and help you further. That's pretty good in terms of recent activity, but of course that's all on my public X profile. It'll be interesting to see how memories on Grok develops over time. Let's try following up by asking it something based on memory. Build a workout that's personal to me. And it seems to be searching the web first and foremost. Based on your enthusiasm for technology and your attendance of NAB in Las Vegas, how about we do an FSD fitness circuit? Full self-driving, I like that. 20 to 30 minutes, 3 to 4 times a week. Just use my body weight and dumbbells if I like. Do it in a hotel room, a gym. It gives me a warm-up, a main workout, stop-and-go squats, push-ups, mountain climbers. I love the fact that it's based it personally on my experience with Tesla's full self-driving, and it gathers the fact I'm a bit of a traveler by the fact I was recently at an event. See here, the workout reflects my tech passion, busy event schedule, and practical yet engaging fitness routine. Very cool indeed. Workspaces is also new inside Grok. These are kind of like projects in ChatGPT where you can work on individual plans, but also now, if you start to create code, and let's use the example I was trying earlier on, create an app that can find the best ancient druid sites, it now opens up what is like a canvas or a place where it can work on your code and you can work back and forth and update it. But what's more, once it's finished with the code, it will actually run the app right inside Grok. And here we go, we're straight into the preview, and this is very nice. I noticed that I didn't say use a Google map, so it's used OpenStreetMap. And there we have the tar steps, we have grey weathers, we have Merivale Stone Circle, Drizzlecomb, and we can actually click on these, and wow, look at that, it zooms right into the spots on the map I'd like to go to. This is very slick, and all I did was type this one short prompt into Grok. If I want to change it, because I'm now working inside a canvas in Grok, I can say add ability to add things to favorites. And then Grok should then go ahead and start immediately thinking about how it's going to update the code. And yeah, it's rewriting the code for me right here in front of my very eyes. So this is why I say that the future of AI coding is browser-based and not necessarily IDE-based or command line-based. And here we go. It's just finishing up with this latest code before it'll go and spin up the preview again. And here we are in the preview. And now you can see I've got some stars here. I can actually star things and it adds it to my favorites. Of course, I can refine this further. And we've got a map that we can zoom in and out of. So again, simple prompting, browser-based app development, really cool stuff from Grok. And memories as well. It can create workout plans, and I'm sure in the future, much more that's personal to me. What do you think about these tools this week? Let me know in the comments down below. And I am going to Exmoor and Dartmoor this weekend. So if you've got any suggestions on things I should visit, let me know about those in the comments too. Thank you so much for watching. I always appreciate you being there. I do have a community. There's over 10,000 of us discussing AI tools, AI coding, and AI apps. So get in there. The link will be down below as well. Thank you for watching. And YouTube is showing a video on your screen right now. You should watch next. Thanks.